better.
That's as far as I go, I promise. I'm going to read a verse of Scripture, Galatians, the third chapter. We always stand in respect to the Word of God, and that's a very biblical thing that we find listed in the Old Testament. Really, Isaiah 53 was what the spotlight was on this evening, but we'll read one short verse, Galatians 3, and verse 13. It says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Father, we pray that you would most definitely hide me behind the cross tonight. We do not want to hear from me, Lord, my thoughts, my perceptions, my comments. But we want to hear from your word, Lord, and we want to remember the name of Jesus when we leave this place this evening. So help us to listen. Help us to worship you by the way that we listen, by the way that we process. Help us to realize we have been created and we are accountable to you, Lord, and you love us. And Father, if we doubt that this evening, we pray that we would at least be open to allowing you to express your love and your concern, your mercy and your grace to us this evening. Bless your word. Thank you that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. We ask it in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen. You can be seated, friends. Sounded like Phil had a big amen section in the back there with Emily. She liked what Grandpa was saying, right? So that was pretty cool. Very difficult for me, even at the hospital, people will say to me, Pastor Gary, you always seem to get us laughing and then you zing us, you know? And that has always been my way, that I enjoy joking around a little bit, but I get serious about certain issues at certain times where I can't find a shred of anything that is funny tonight about the topic. You're doubting that, aren't you? You think I can find a shred? Yeah. I don't think there's anything funny about what we're looking at this evening and as we process what Jesus Christ did for us. When I came to Christ at 18 years of age, my life did not suddenly get better across the board. I still got flat tires. My car still broke down. I still got rained on. I still got sick. I still lost family members that I loved dearly. But I suddenly had a God that I could lean on and trust and draw from his mercy in the hardest of times. I keep hearing people say, when I get my life together, when I get my life together, I'll return to the Lord. Well, I want to let you in on a little secret. It is going to get harder and harder in certain areas in our life as we grow older. And we need to lean more and more and more on the Son of God and realize that he is greater than anything that we are going through. So tonight we're going to look at Christ's seven statements from the cross. He made seven statements. I'm going to be very serious about it. I'm not going to linger long on any one statement. In fact, I'm not even going to be flipping through the Word of God. I'm probably going to read it right off of the PowerPoint so that we can move along smoothly through the sermon this evening. But I want to mention something to you about Jesus and this Good Friday and him going to the cross for our sin. It is not God's fault that there is evil in the world. We are not robots. Adam and Eve were given free will. They were not robots. They were able to choose, and they chose wrong. And they were the representatives of the human race. And because of that, we are all born dead in trespasses and sin. As I joke with you so often, you don't have to teach a small child how to say no. You don't have to teach a small child how to throw a temper tantrum. You don't have to teach a teenager how to have a bad attitude or to be rebellious. These are things we're born with. And yet we have to teach people how to say please and thank you and I'm sorry, because we are born with this sin nature. Jesus went to the cross to bridge the gap, to give us an opportunity as being sinners to be able to return to God. I know we're finite. I know that our days are numbered. And I know it's hard for us to understand eternity. But Jesus came to die so that a kingdom could be established, the kingdom of heaven for all eternity, so that we might have a home there and be sinless because of his work on the cross. I dealt with it at the hospital today. People saying to me, but don't I need to do this? And don't I need to do that? I have one particular unit at the hospital. These ladies are with it. And the questions they ask me are deep and intriguing. And it takes a lot of time to try to give them the answers that they're looking for, because they're good questions. Some things we must receive by faith and trust God as we move along. Jesus, as you know, the beginning of the Passion Week, traveled through Jerusalem, the triumphant entry. Palm leaves were thrown on the ground. A donkey was obtained through the disciples, and they put their own clothing on the donkey that had never been ridden. And Jesus rode on the back of that donkey, and the people, tens of thousands, cried out, Hosanna to God in the highest. The religious leaders became very nervous because the attention was not on them. It was on Jesus. And they said to Jesus, warn your disciples. They're bordering on worship. They're going just a little bit too far. And Christ said, even if they would hold their peace, the rocks would cry out and praise me. Because even creation praises God, because Jesus is the Creator. By the end of the week, he had that Last Supper with his disciples. He was betrayed in the Garden of Gethsemane with a kiss by Judas. They put up a little bit of a fight. Peter drew his sword and cut off the ear of the high priest's servant, Malchus. Jesus reached down, picked up the ear, and put it back on the side of the high priest's servant's head, because Jesus had come to die. It was all going according to plan. There was no failure here. It was all victorious. Even though people continued to tempt Christ to come down from the cross and not go through the suffering and not fulfill all of the prophecies. We find he went through a scourging, and this is probably the one that just breaks my heart the most when I read about it. The cat of nine tails, the whip that had nine strands of leather, and on the end of the leather were thinner strands. And on those strands were pieces of metal and pieces of stone. And as they whipped the Lord Jesus Christ, these pieces of metal and stone actually ripped pieces, chunks of skin off of the back of our Savior. They were not permitted to give any more than 39 lashes because they thought that was as far as they could go for a man to stay alive and yet still be crucified. So they gave him those 39 lashes, and most people did die during that flogging. But Christ did not die. And then he took that journey with that cross on his back till Golgotha on a hill that was called the Place of the Skull. And there he had his feet nailed to that tree and became a curse for us. And he hung there between heaven and earth as the perfect redemptive work of Almighty God. And thank God that he did. Thank God that he didn't come down. Thank God that he didn't say we weren't worth it. Thank God that he had unconditional love for us. And every sin, eternity past, eternity present, and eternity future was taken upon Jesus. He became sin for us. Every wicked thought, every vile sin, you look around in our world today and start naming the sins, start naming the ugliness and the vulgarity. It all hung on Jesus Christ, but it was all His plan, the plan of God. I wasn't looking for God when I came to Christ at age 18. I was kind of religious. My family loved God, and I just kind of went along for the ride, you know, and I went to church, but it didn't mean much to me. I couldn't wait till I got out, and I didn't necessarily act right while I was there as a child, as a teen. You know, it took a while for me to realize I was sitting before God, and He died for me, and He created me. And I was accountable to Him. But once He touched my heart, because I was asking questions, why am I here? What's my purpose? Why is there so much suffering in this world? I need answers. Life has to be more than the jobs we work and the houses we buy and the cars we drive and being in competition with people around us. It has to be more than that. If there is a God, and He revealed Himself to me. So Christ is nailed to that cross. He's hanging there. I can't imagine what my thought process would be if I was hanging on a cross with a spike through my feet between two thieves who deserved to be there, but I had done nothing wrong. So Christ says some things that are amazing. Maybe we can throw a little bit of clarification upon them tonight. First off, He says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Luke 23 and verse 34, then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they divided His garments and cast lots. There you are hanging between heaven and earth. You're forgiving the people around you. And as you look down below, they are gambling for the few possessions that you have as a game. Nobody wanted what He wore. Nobody wanted what He had. This is the God of the universe. This is the God who hung the world on nothing. This is the God who by Him all things consist. The beginning and the end, the author and the finisher of our faith, the one who has a purpose and a plan for you, and He died even for those down below who were gambling for the very little bit that He had. Now, if you have a Bible, Psalm 103, verses 10 to 14, if you did get a bulletin tonight, you can certainly take some notes and look at those things, but we're talking about forgiveness. You know, forgiveness is one of the biggest things, the hardest things we deal with. Forgiving people, not holding grudges, being angry, which eventually leads to bitterness. But God forgave us. When that screen comes up in a little while, there'll be a cross there, and we'll get a chance to remember the forgiveness and the mercy and the grace and the restoration of God. Psalm 103, verses 10 to 14 says, He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is His mercy toward those who fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear Him. For He knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. He remembers. He knows that we are weak. So the cross and our night together is a picture of forgiveness. That's why before we have communion, we always have a time of examination. We always give people an opportunity to think about the situations in their life. Maybe the people they haven't forgiven. maybe the people they haven't released in their life. And you know, the Bible teaches that we are to forgive to simply, first off, release ourselves so that we're not walking around bitter and we can walk around with a renewed Christ-like attitude. We find, secondly, Christ said to one of those thieves on either side of him, "Today, you will be with me in paradise." Luke 23:43, and Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Does that move on? Never mind. He was saved the 11th hour. Can you get any closer to dying than hanging on a cross? And Jesus looked at him, and one thief mocked him. One thief said, "If you are God, get us out of here. Get us off this cross. Prove yourself." But Jesus wasn't coming down because he had come to die. He had come to be the Lamb which takes away the sin of the world, for you and for me. I know we don't always feel like we need forgiveness. We don't always feel like we need restoration. But God tells us we do. The Bible says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." In our present state, we cannot go to heaven. We need forgiveness. We need the blood of Christ to wash away our sin. And listen, I still have the brain of a teenager, but I have gotten older and it has amazed me. I am in the last leg of the race, and if you're older than me, you probably say, "Stop it, you're depressing me." But life goes fast. We're going to be there before we know it. We're going to stand before Jesus. And listen, what will take place depends on what decisions we make here and now. Christ said, "You must be born again." Not crawling back into your mother's womb, John 3, but being born from above into the family of God because we receive him as Lord and Savior. That's why he hung there. Don't you think if there had been another way for us to be able to go to heaven, God was smart enough to show it to us? If there had been any other way. But there wasn't. The only way was a perfect sacrifice. Everything in the Old Testament was a picture of that perfect sacrifice. So he says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Who else can say that? I can't offer you paradise. Nobody else can. But Jesus looks at a man hanging on a cross and he says, "You called me Lord. You believe in me, and today, because you've acknowledged me as God, you will be with me in paradise." This thief had a better understanding of what Jesus was dying for than his disciples did. Because why would you ask this when you're hanging on a cross? Remember me? What do you mean? When you come into your kingdom, remember me. Saved at the 11th hour. It's much better if you receive Christ while you still have strength in your body. So you can serve God and you can say, "Thank you, God. And I'm not going to hell, I'm going to heaven. And I do have a support system. I do have a Savior who is merciful and gracious." Much better to give him as much of your life as you can. I have led people to Christ on their deathbed. Thank God that he's so merciful that somebody just laying there can still receive Christ. I have whispered into people's ears that are supposedly in a coma, non-responsive, hooked up to every machine possible. And you know what I do? I whisper in their ear and I give them the plan of salvation because I know that the hearing is the last thing to go. And they still might be hearing, even though we think that they are not processing things. Today you'll be with me in paradise. Thirdly, this one breaks my heart. Behold your son, behold your mother. John 19:26 says, when Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved, John, standing by, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. We had a lot of fun Sunday with that woman thing, didn't we, a couple weeks ago? You know, my mom would be quite upset if I said, woman, come on over here. You know, she would think that was probably disrespectful. And in our culture, it would be disrespectful. But it wasn't disrespectful. There was much respect from looking at a woman in the days of Christ and saying, woman. But I wondered, as he hung on the cross and he looked down and saw Mary, saw his mom, why he just didn't say, mom. Her heart had to be breaking. Her standing there made this scene more horrific. A mother looking up at her son, beaten to a bloody pulp, nailed to a tree, becoming a curse, everyone turning on him. Her heart must have been so broken. And then I thought about it, and I thought, you know, he might have said woman so that he didn't mark her. If he had said, mom, hey, this was a hostile crowd. Maybe by saying woman, he was just being respectful and not giving anyone the idea that she was his mother. And then he looks at John, the disciple whom he loved, who was the closest, and he points at Mary and he says, behold your mother. And what he was saying was, you take care of mom for me. Take her home with you. She's been through a lot. Remember Mary receiving that announcement from the angels that she would be overshadowed by the Holy Spirit of God and she would be with child, God with us, Emmanuel? Remember what that was like for her as she pondered those things in her heart? As she watched as Joseph got behind her and was supportive because God gave Joseph a dream? Remember those shepherds coming and falling down at the feet of her baby and worshiping him, following a star? The wise men coming and looking at Jesus and saying, this is him, this is the Messiah, this is who the prophecies spoke of? Do you understand how she felt? She pondered all those things in her heart and she said, behold the handmaid of the Lord. Be it unto me according to your will. Whatever you want to do, Lord, even to stand at the foot of a horrific scene like the cross. It probably crossed her mind, Jesus' first steps. When he talked for the first time, when he said, mama, the first time. She probably looked at him sitting there across the table as a little boy, knowing this was the Son of God. 12 years old, they've left the temple and he stayed behind. They lost him for a bit. They traveled back and he was baffling all of the scribes and all of the men of wisdom in the temple. And he was 12. She must have thought an awful lot to herself. And now she's standing at the cross. She watched the flogging. She watched as they plucked his beard out. She watched as they took a crown of thorns, and these thorns in the Holy Land are huge. And they drove it down into his head, into his skull. She watched all this. And now she's watching this mockery, and she knows her son has not done anything wrong. And Jesus is able to look down and think about people that are gambling for his clothing. He's able to think about a thief. He's able to look down and say, hey, take care of my mom. What a Savior. What a great God. What great forgiveness and mercy and grace we receive from the Lord. And then the fourth thing, this is the one hardest for you and I to understand. He said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Mark, the 15th chapter in verse 34, says, and at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me? The people of the day thought he was crying out for Elijah to come and to rescue him off of the cross. People at the hospital today, they were like beside themselves. Wait a minute. Jesus is God and he's there and he's talking to God and he's saying, why have you forsaken me? Why have you turned your back on me? We got into a whole discussion about the Trinity. So confusing. It's hard. But we have to accept it by faith. God the Father, who is holy and just, could not look at his Son because his Son had become sin. And it was our sin that hung on him. Remember, you're dealing with a Savior who's 100% God and 100% man. A God in the Garden of Gethsemane who said, if it be possible, Father, take this cup from me. But nevertheless, your will, not my will, be done. Can you imagine being with God the Father for all eternity past, all eternity present, all eternity future, and suddenly you're separated from your Father? I can't understand that, except I know how we feel when we are separated from somebody we love. And this relationship went on for all eternity. Hard for us to understand that a father could not gaze on his son. And his earthly mom is sitting down there looking up with tears in her eyes. How Christ must have been torn. Hebrews 10, verses 11 and 12 says, and every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sin. But this man, speaking of Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down, that means you're done, at the right hand of God. He completed his work. There are religious leaders today, I'm glad I'm not one of them, who are ministering sacrifices over and over again. I want you to understand tonight, the bread, it does not become the body of Christ. The juice, it does not become the blood of Christ. It is symbolic of what Christ did for us on the cross by shedding his blood and his body being broken and nailed to a tree on our behalf. The work of the cross was complete and sufficient. And when he was done, he sat down at the right hand of God. The work's been done. All we need to do is the receiving part. I know you died for me, Jesus. I know you love me. I know you have a purpose for my life. I don't understand it all, but I need you. And then we see the humanity of Christ in our fifth point. I thirst. I'm thirsty. Hanging on a cross, showing his humanity. John 19 and verse 28 says, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Isn't it amazing that every prophecy of the Old Testament he had to fulfill or he would not be God? Every single one of them. He was aware of every prophecy that had been made. And now he shows he's human. Hebrews 4:15 says, for we have not a high priest who cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmity, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. You and I can never say, you don't know how I feel. You don't know what I've been through. Why are you laying all this on me? If you really understand the humanity of Christ, he's been there and then some. And he tells us he won't give us more than we can bear. He is a father who pities his children. And if you're anything like me, I am a whiner. Big time. And I complain and I compare myself with others and I say, why not me? Why is he or she being blessed? Why not me? And maybe you're the same way sometimes. He has experienced every human emotion. He said, I thirst. The soldiers on the end of a stick sent up a sponge that was dipped in sour wine. A drink that the poor drank. And they gave him a sponge. I watched Sheila as we visited her and I teased her. And Rachel, you know about this too. When you're so thirsty and all they'll give you is a stick with a little sponge on the end of it. You know, it's like I'd be throwing those things at the nurses. I'd be throwing those things at the doctors. I'd be saying, get that thing out of here. I'd be cheating. I'd be chewing on ice. I'd be stealing my roommate's drink. You know, maybe you did that, Rachel. I don't know. But I would be doing that. Jesus has given a sponge with sour wine because he was experiencing thirst. And he wanted his thirst to be quenched. The sixth thing, he said, it is finished. The Greek word tetelestai, paid in full, because he was done with his redemptive work. John 19 and verse 30 says, so when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Do you realize that's a miracle? Just to decide when you're going to die? Okay, that's it. And you're gone. Because your work on earth is done. These things that he did were according to Scripture. 1 John 2:2 says, and he is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the entire world. Propitiation meaning payment. We had to have our sin paid for. We had to be redeemed. We had to be purchased back. Anybody bring some cans to the Redemption Center lately? I watched some people over at BJ's. I mean, some of those women with 20 bags of cans, you know? Bringing those cans back, redeeming them. The cross, if we accept what was done on it, we've been purchased back. We've been bought back. We're something valuable now, not because of us, but because of what Jesus did. And receiving him into our lives. What did John the Baptist say? Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. And then finally, the seventh thing, he said, Father, into your hand I commit my spirit. Luke 23 and verse 46 says, and when Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Having said this, he breathed his last. And what is being echoed here, if you want to write it down, is Psalm 31:5. It's often called the word of reunion, where the Son is reunited in heaven with his Father. That's pretty exciting because in John, the 17th chapter, Christ asks to share the glory with his Father that he had shared before the foundation of the world, before we were even around. He says, return that, the glory that we shared, Father. And then in Hebrews 1, God the Father talks about glorifying God the Son and having what they had and what they shared before the world was created. I wish sometimes that I could explain things in a better way. that you would grab a hold of the fact that this is not it. We are not home yet. Jesus, his church, his work, is more important than anything we do. And we continually put them on the back burner. And we think happiness will come from a variety of things. Happiness never comes from those things. It's momentary. It's fleeting. God will give you joy for all eternity. And here and now. I mean, do I look like a person that's miserable for the most part? I have my moments. I have an awful lot of fun. I enjoy myself. I like teasing with you. We have a good time. We tell jokes. I love life. I love it because Jesus is my Savior. I can laugh at myself. I can tell jokes about myself. It's good to know that we have a great, great God. Into your hand I commit my spirit. And in closing, folks, this evening, I want you to focus on the cross. You can put the screen up, buddy. I want you to focus on the cross behind me as we look at forgiveness. I should have taken that up here with me. Didn't he look cool the way he did that? He thought nobody saw him. You were so indiscreet. No one even saw that happen. You look at that cross and think about forgiveness. Think about restoration. Think about a bridge to God, our only hope. John 14 and verse 6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Acts 4:12 says, neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. John 1:12 says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. I talked to three ladies at the hospital today, and they said at the end, so we're all set, right? I said, not yet. You need to receive him. Well, didn't he die for everyone? Yes, he did. Enough precious blood was spilt for every person who would call on him. But we have a responsibility to be born again, to receive Christ, to give our life to him, even if we don't understand things. And he promises that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Would you do me a favor and bow your heads for a moment with me? Heads bowed and eyes closed. We're going to be observing the Lord's Supper soon and examining ourselves and thinking about the blood and thinking about the body that was broken on our behalf. You don't need to point right now. And we'll be doing that in a moment, but maybe right now, just in the quiet of this evening, maybe you'd say to me, Pastor Gary, I've been around the block, or I got a lot of stuff. I got things I'm going through. I got pain. I have sorrow. I don't understand it all, but by my uplifted hand, I just want you to know, I think I need Jesus. And I'm not going to embarrass you or call out your name or say where you're sitting. But maybe just an uplifted hand. You say, hey, I think I need Jesus. Keep me in prayer. Anybody like that tonight? I did that when I was 18. Best decision I ever made in my life. Jesus shed enough blood for everybody in this world to be saved. But we must receive him as Lord and Savior. Maybe his seven statements from the cross gripped your heart this evening, or something jumped out at you and say, hey, Pastor, pray for me tonight. God moved in my heart in a special way. Pray for me. Anybody like that tonight? I see your hand, brother. I see your hand, dear lady. I see your hand, brother. Hands all over. Amen. Amen. I see your hands. I see your hands. Praise God. That's good. That's good. Sometimes we have to push aside the cares of the world and center in on the Lord. He knows our thoughts afar off. He knows what we're up against. And we desperately, desperately need Him. Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your love. Thank you that you pity us like a father pities his children. Thank you that you know our frame. You know that we're but dust. Lord, we don't know what we're doing sometimes. We're just little weak men and women. And we need your hand. We need your power. We need your provision. So many of us run around like we're in charge and we're in control of things. We can't control anything. We need you. And Lord, it's not a game. It's your purpose for our life, that we would acknowledge you and love you and find out your plan for our lives. Lord God, we want each one here to come to a saving knowledge of Christ and have a home in heaven. And Lord, to find out it'll make life here and now so much better. So many folks here tonight have lost family members who have never called out to Christ. They're just trying to make it, trying to survive. And they need God. Lord, we pray that we would keep offering them up before you. Thank you for your word this evening and the hands that were raised. We ask it in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen. If you look up, I just want to read a portion of scripture to you that will kind of drive home what we're going to be doing with the Lord's Supper tonight. If you want to follow along with me, I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. I'm going to read verses 24 through 31. 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, verses 24 to 31. It says, "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged." You can come back up to that piano, Linda. I want to give you an opportunity to bow your head and to examine yourself tonight. Let me tell you what we're doing when we do this. We look at the cross, we're thinking of forgiveness. Can we possibly remember a forgiving act of God, an unconditional love, and we have a problem with somebody? We have a problem with a family member. We have a problem with somebody in church or a neighbor, and we're angry, and we haven't forgiven them. God wants us to do business with him concerning that situation tonight. I've seen people in churches who have gotten up and walked over to somebody and said, "I'm sorry. I want things to be right." I've been in large churches that have done that. I've been in small churches that have done that. I've been in one church where a pastor had a fight with his wife, and she was in the nursery, and he said, "Excuse me." And he left the sanctuary, and he went down and made things right with his wife because he knew he couldn't partake if he didn't get things right with her. So it's important that we bow our heads for a couple of moments. You can start playing, Linda, and examine ourselves tonight. Would you take a couple of minutes just to bow before the Lord? Spend a few moments with him. You know who you are. You know how you think. You know where you need to do business with Jesus tonight. Why don't you do that?
You have helped me, Lord.